Pan Prasad, acclaimed author D. Shyam Babu and the President and Chief Executive of the Center for Policy Research, Yamini Iyer.
Hello. Hello, everyone. I welcome you all to this discussion, which I hope will be both interesting and illuminating, and we'll have some debating points. Before we get to the topic today, Dalit as Entrepreneurs 2.0, a brief background on the subject. Now, as we all know that caste is a fundamental reality of this country. Based on hierarchy, it has been among the prime reasons for the country being a deeply iniquitous society. For centuries, those at the bottom of the caste pyramid have endured the worst of everything that a human being can undergo: untouchability, economic deprivation, sexual violence, and worse. Now, over the centuries, there have been attempts to change the status quo. The Satnamis, who later fought against Aurangzeb, emerged out of an anti-caste movement. Then there was Sant Ravidas of the 15th century, who unleashed a frontal attack on the long tradition of social oppression and untouchability. There are many such examples in the medieval period. Changes also happened, although not all of them was intended, during the British rule. Now, one of them was Thomas Macaulay's Minute on Education, which democratized and broad-based education, a rather radical idea for its time. Many see him as an Englishman who was trying to push for colonialism through the language, and that might well have been the intent of his at that time. But there's no denying the fact that Macaulay's initiative theoretically freed education from the clutches of caste and religion. We also know about the changes that happened in our society through the influence and intervention of Ambedkar and Gandhi. In post-independence, in independent India, progressive parties, as well as state policies, such as reservation in education as well as in jobs, helped the scheduled caste make upward stride. Now, in most parts of India, Dalits have diversified away from being farm workers. Because of all the policies of the government for the past 60, 70 years, there's a small but visible Dalit middle class which has emerged. And the logical extension of that middle class is the next phase, Dalit as entrepreneurs, which is our topic for the day. Now, we have used the word 2.0 because the Dalit Chamber of Commerce was set up in 2005. And one of our panelists, Chandrabhan Prasad, he played a key role in its setting. And he is the one who first said, be jobs givers, not job seekers. Now, 5 years ago, Devesh Kapoor, then at the University of Pennsylvania and now at Johns Hopkins University, along with Chandrabhan and Shyam Babu, brought out the seminal book, Defying the Odds, The Rise of Dalit Entrepreneurs. The book told the story of 21 Dalit entrepreneurs, most of them running businesses, running into crores. And thousands of mediums and large Dalit entrepreneurs were identified and surveyed during the writing of this book. It was estimated at that point of time that the combined turnover was in the region of $1 billion. Now, my first question is to Mr. Chandrabhan Prasad. I saw on Twitter that, you know, now you're also bringing out this magazine, Dalit Entrepreneurs. You're bringing out this magazine. And for the past few months, or maybe a couple of years, you have been traveling extensively and meeting Dalit entrepreneurs all over the country. Yesterday, you posted on Twitter from Phagwara, where you had met an entrepreneur and spoke about his business. What is the larger thing that you'd see has happened in the past few years?
Yeah, I was in Punjab for...
Use the mic.
For 2 days, and in districts of Phagwara, Nawansahar, and Firozpur, there are 19 Dalit-owned hospitals.
19.
So far, we have published 4 editions of Dalit Enterprise focusing on Uttar Pradesh. Yeah. In Uttar Pradesh alone, there are about 180 Dalit-owned hospitals. So, some even 200-bedded hospitals, 100-bedded hospitals. So if we profile 20 Dalit entrepreneurs every month, and if I keep profiling only Dalit-owned hospitals, that will be 240 or so in a year. It may take 10 years for me and my team to profile only Dalit-owned hospitals. Other businesses are huge. So enterprise has very silently and steadily turned into a big game among Dalits, and that has been unnoticed by mainstream academia, media, even assemblies and parliament.
You spoke about hospitals. Which are the other areas where Dalits have made a mark as entrepreneurs?
They have made mark in manufacturing. If 13 motor parts makers in Faridabad go on strike for a month, maybe few big companies will stop production of their cars and trucks. They're so huge everywhere, Faridabad, Ghaziabad, Ballabgarh, Gurgaon.
So you said hospitals, manufacturing. Yeah, these are the 2 main areas.
Yes, and Dalits are very few in trading. And that's why we keep saying that let us invite Walmart and all these guys, because trading is most caste based, where Dalits find it very hard to enter. There are a few.
Yeah, you see, doing business in India itself is quite difficult. So you know, it can be argued that everyone who is not a Dalit also faces a lot of challenges as a businessman or as an aspiring businessman. What is specific to the problem that a Dalit entrepreneur or a Dalit aspiring to be an entrepreneur faces?
I have met around 1,000 Dalit entrepreneurs in the past 9 years. Only 2 families have traditional business that they have inherited. Rest all are new. Because they are new, and because business is not in the Dalit tradition, they lack soft skilling. A Dalit entrepreneur took loan of 50 lakh rupees from somebody, some private lender. When the private lender said, I'll take only 3% interest from you. He was so happy, he said, banks take 10%, 8%. Later, after he had taken the loan, he realized that it is 3% per month. Yeah. So it's 36% per year. So they don't have soft skilling. Not many have regular CA. Not many keep books. Not many know the trend of business market world. So not many brand their products. In fact, in Ghaziabad, Dalits make shoes for Haspapi, Bata, famous international brand. And at least four people export to European market, but they don't have their brands. A particular shoe Dalit makes in Agra, he sells it at 2,000 rupees a pair in wholesale, and Raymond sells it for 10,000 rupees. Dalits make leather coats for European market, but none of them have their brand. So the marketing skill, brand making, these are the areas where they are missing.
My next question is to Shyam Babu. Shyam Babu, Chandabhan is talking about the success of Dalit entrepreneurs in a major way in certain aspects. How many, you know, what's the number that you would give to Dalit entrepreneurs in this country? And what do you think have been the larger political social conditions which has allowed this success to happen? Probably post 1991 reforms.
I would say serious entrepreneurs, you can count them in thousands. But a few hundred have done extremely well. But your larger question, yes, things have drastically improved since 1991 liberalization. But a stage was set for this phase to succeed. As you rightly mentioned, it all started with Macaulay, not so much about English education. His IPC, CRPC, first time in our recorded history, we accepted the norm that individual is the unit, not his identity. There's not even a gender discrimination in the IPC, CRPC to a large extent. So that set the stage. Then the independence movement and the government of India, and we tend to argue, Chandrabhanji is also one of them, that the Indian state has been quite successful in unleashing a social change in favor of the downtrodden, including scheduled castes and scheduled tribes. But we tend to blame the state for everything, but I believe state has done extremely well. Even after 1991, the state interventions and state's ideal to bring about a social change that benefits everybody is to a large extent responsible for the current phase of Dalit entrepreneurs who are succeeding on themselves.
Yamini, both Chandrabhan and Shyam Babu are quite gung-ho about Dalit entrepreneurs. India has 250 million Dalits, estimatedly, if you go by projections post 2011. There is, in this exuberance, I would say, we might be losing focus on the fact that, atrocities continue to happen. We have the example of the 2016 flogging in Una. The, whenever there is an inter-caste love story, it generally ends badly, usually. And then again, this headline has been a near constant for the past 30, 40 years, which I'm reading newspapers, that ghodi pe chadna, during a wedding. So are they being, is this the way to go about for the community? What do you think, or they are being over, positive about the situation, based on your experience from the ground?
So I think what I find really compelling about the narrative and what I have learned from interacting and reading their work is that it is very important to recognize different forces of change. And India, just by nature of the way public discourse evolves and the very, very central, front and center role of the state as the agent of initiating social change, has tended to limit its discourse and understanding very much to what the state can and cannot do, and that includes the shaping of politics. And also, perhaps in order to mobilize the public, the politics and create consensus on the atrocities in and of themselves. We don't have enough positive narratives of change, which in some senses are self-driven, but also part and parcel of the larger set of shifts that are taking place in our social, in our society, in our markets, in our economy, and in our politics. And we, in all of this, what we tend to underestimate is the importance of wealth creation for social change. And in fact, if you look at some of the work that has been done on questions of race in the US, and I'm absolutely not comparing the two, I think they are very, very different, but you know, over the 1990s, there was a very, and early 2000s, a very big questions being asked about accumulated capital. So even as you create an elite that are black, the accumulated capital, both in terms of money and social capital of the whites versus the blacks, have always meant that the struggles are much more significant, despite a society that is in many ways overcome some challenges, although deeply structured. So I think that both, the fact that one is able to put a lens on how deeply structural and oppressed communities are able to participate in moments of change, and also importantly, build systems for wealth creation, which I think leverage for future change. These stories we don't hear about. When you open the newspapers, as you rightly say, the headlines tell you something. When you look at deep academic work, it actually sometimes puts you in a moment of complete stuck. You don't know where to move from here. And when you look at the discourse on our politics, that stuck feels even greater. So for all those reasons, I think celebrating this, engaging with it, positively understanding what the implications of this are is very important. Having said that, of course, and I don't think it is the case, both of Chandrabhan or Shyam's work, that this is the only part of the story. There is, of course, a lot else. And it is important to keep our eye on that lot else. And I think what worries me, actually, in terms of how, where we are today and how we look forward, is both that the momentum that was generated of the 1990s and 2000s in political life and in the role of the state has, I think, reached a certain stuck. And that stuck has perhaps been a consequence of the, you know, you sort of hit the glass ceiling, now how do you crash, how do you break it? And it's not clear that alternative narratives are emerging. And also we have a much, much more aspirational, more mobile, more agile demographic. And in this, in fact, if you look at what is happening to the most oppressed communities, what is happening to in rural India, you find that the larger atrophy of our institutions and the state is in fact most impacting these communities. And for example, I do a lot of work on elementary education. And one of the big debates we have in elementary education is the role of the private sector. Village after village after village where you travel, you see the big difference between work even a decade, decade and a half ago and today is that we are no longer talking about getting children into schools or getting schools to children. We are talking about what's happening in classrooms. And in that conversation, the move towards the private sector has become a very big one. So parents are moving their children off and putting them into private schools. But the most oppressed and the most marginalized, who don't necessarily have the means, are finding their children now left in government schools. And that has created a significant social distance between who is the teacher and who is the student. And that lack of understanding and that lack of sense of solidarity really plays out in how, so we are creating a whole new kind of market-driven, in some senses, caste structure that is further deepening some of the structural constraints in which we are functioning. And I think that we need to recognize this and engage with this much, much more. Lastly, I think one of the most important and interesting shifts, there are two shifts I feel that are taking place amongst the way young Dalits are talking about themselves. One is a recognition of wanting to go back to their past and owning it, telling my story, but telling my story as me in a very deeply structurally constrained environment. The second is a sense of anger with where we are And that's where I think you're seeing new movements, new agitations evolving. And it is, I think the future is going to be very much linked with how these agitations actually convert themselves into something more meaningful.
Since you have been working with various communities, including Dalits, you know, over a period of time, one thing, you know, in the books that they have worked on, there have been, you know, basically when we talk about Dalit entrepreneurs, we are talking about men Dalit entrepreneurs. There is, in this book, you know, Defying the Odds, there are 21, I think, chapters, and there is only one on women.
Yes.
Do you see any change, you know, in that aspect, you know, more confidence in terms of, or more entrepreneurship, even at a small level, even at a panchayat level or at a village level?
I think a little more so in political spaces, far less so in our economic life. And I think that is also part and parcel of the complex challenge of state-led interventions for change, markets evolving. Markets, all, you know, we always assume that markets would somehow get past all of these because the logic of markets is individual neutral. But in fact, markets tend to reinforce social bias, social prejudice, and structural constraints. And I think I see that quite a lot. But I do think that even when state-led intervention creates heroes, it doesn't create deep social change, and that's something we do need to confront head on and think about harder.
Lucknow has 24 Dalit-owned hospitals, and three hospitals are created by Dalit women doctors.
Okay.
There is a 100-bed hospital in Faizabad, made by these doctor couples. I asked Mrs. Kiran, who is the real trigger for this hospital? You are your husband.
Yeah.
She said, "Aap mere saath do din se ghum rahe hain na? Hum log saath." Maine kaha, "Do din se ghum raha hoon, research kar raha hoon. Abhi tak aapko pata nahi chala kaun iska asli banane wala hai." She was so confident. So this post 1991 Dalits are, they appear a different kind of human beings. You know, they have moved much faster from state production kind of thing into market economy. But the impression of society about this new age Dalits is that they are still into ration card and job seeking category. So Dalit, young, new generation Dalit is moving faster, and the response of society is much lower.
You have been interacting with them. Why don't you share some of the anecdotes that you know about these people, you know, the kind of challenges they have faced, and you know, the kind of things that they have come up with. You know, you're meeting these people, you were talking about them.
You know, there is a, D. Shambhu knows, there is a Dalit entrepreneur in Bangalore. He's son of a Dalit civil servant. He's son of a Dalit civil servant. And he's engineer. Engineer means not IT engineer, he's a proper mechanical engineer.
Balu.
He was declined by 24 girls, one by one. Because aap naukri kya karte hain? No, I am not doing any naukri. I have a factory. No, but for living, what is your job? So he was declined 24 times. So within the Dalit community, Dalit entrepreneurs, the response of the overall Dalit society is very poor towards Dalit entrepreneurs. They still look for inspector, teacher, degree college lecturer, PCS officer, government employed, PSU employed, people when they look for bridegrooms.
There are 4 million Dalits in government jobs right now, according to your...
Yeah, 4 million Dalits, and according to our estimate, that is very conservative, combined income of Dalit employees and officers is up to $50 billion. And if you compare by countries, there are 39 countries that are less than $50 billion in GDP. So there's a huge Dalit middle class that has come into being, but neither the society, nor the government, nor the academic recognizes that. I was talking to a car manager of a car making company. I said, I want from your company. He said, ki, where are Dalit car buyers? You know, in ONGC, gross salary of an officer with 20 years of service beyond 6 lakh rupees a month. In ILPSU, every salary is 40 lakh rupees a year. There are thousands and thousands of Dalits who are in this income category. But neither we recognize them as a market force, as a Dalit that much of purchasing power, nor state makes plannings to address aspirations of the this class of Dalits and their kids. So there is complete disconnect from policy makers to this rising Dalits. So they get like debt trap is a new phenomenon because they don't know from where to, they don't get money loan from public sector banks, government banks, so they go to private lenders.
They don't have that networking.
Yes, yes.
But, I just wanted to say that I completely agree with you, but I think it's worth also recognizing the reason behind that, which comes from a very, it's one of the limitations of state-led social change in a sense, where if you look at the 80s, 90s, the big political movements especially, the whole, and where the state was a primary source of power, and the state was a primary source of social mobility. The entire mobilization was about acquiescing power of the state, and then consolidating that power. And that is where the deep desire for this government teacher job, the government administrator job, by the way, that's not just limited to Dalit communities. We did a survey of block development officers across 6 different states about 2 years ago, just an informal survey, trying to find out why people still want government jobs. And you got a lot of the usual things, but we wanted to see how aspirations play out and pushed hard to say, would you like your children to have government jobs too? And it was very clear, everybody wants a government job for the so-called power that the government has available to it. But it has also therefore limited the framework of our politics. Our politics is not demanding that policy thinks about community and how communities can self-empower themselves in ways. Our politics is not recognizing the Dalit middle class. And it is only when our politics recognizes it that we will actually see shifts in how we respond to this to the needs of the new aspiring middle class. It's also worth recognizing where are the new agitations coming from? What are the demands of the young Dalits that are agitating and trying to engage in the political space? And there again, I see quite a deep disconnect from what Chandrabhan is talking about and what this new politics is asking for. And I think bridging that, your job is harder than anyone else's because I think it is on you to bridge that at some level, and us, of course.
Yeah. Sure. Neither the politics is recognizing this, even probably as both or all of you are saying that the media or even popular literature or whatever and cinema is recognizing it, you know, because cinema also mirrors social change. You know, traditionally we have seen in literature when you know Premchand wrote about the lower classes with a lot of empathy the names that was used at that time, Dukhi or some, you know, like in Sadgati and all. So we have that image, you know, still endures in popular perception. And even say the Hindi cinema, you know, the films generally show Dalits as as victims rather than survivors. Although you know new films like Newton and all, they have tried to make some kind of a difference or change. My question to you is, what continues, or what are the forces that continue this kind of monochromatic view of Dalits?
You know the famous sociologist M.N. Srinivas made the distinction between book view and field view. We read a book on Indian society and the caste system of Dalits. It might have been written in 60s or 70s or even 90s. Even if it is written 10 years ago, you read the book and go into the field, one doesn't have to be an anthropologist or a sociologist. Go to a village and talk to people, you see so much difference from what you learned through the book. So I don't want to be too critical of the government or even the media for not reflecting that, because the society, Indian society, didn't change for centuries. Maybe in the last 100 and 150 years, it started changing. That change has accelerated since 1991.
Yeah, but you see, this is my interesting. There is a Dalit in Delhi, Chhatarpur. He did to construction.
Yeah.
And he has a Mercedes, a BMW, and that Tata's that new car?
Jaguar.
I said, what are other expensive things you have in your house? So he showed me a shoe. And after sometime he said, he was not telling me the price of the suit. He said, 2 lakh saab liya hum, London se. I said, what are other expensive things in your house? He told me that these stones, he sab videsh se mangaya humne. He has everything. You know what the family doesn't have? Tie. Maine kaha, tie kyun nahi aapke paas? Sab humko angrezi nahi aati hai. So he thinks that only those who are well educated and speak English, only they have right to use tie. So, I mean, there is so much, even society, even Dalits don't accept them as much as a Dalit officer or a Dalit inspector. And there is no politician other than 2-3 people I know in this country where you can go and talk to them about Dalit capitalism. When I talk to some people, they think I am a big fool. On Twitter, I have record. Whenever I go, I tweet about I met this entrepreneur and his BMW and all that. There are many people who very angrily write. Do they help their community? Why are you asking this question? Whether they help the community or not, they have succeeded in their life. They are first generation Dalit. They didn't have much. Yesterday, a doctor said now there are 19 doctors in his family, 4 hospitals, near Phagwara. He says, jitna bada hamara kitchen hai, itne hi bade mein hum bachpan mara gujra, 6 bhai, mata pita, ek bahan. Now 19 members in his family and none of them use reservation or anything, state thing like that. But he says, aap pahli baar aaye hain hamare yahan suit boot mein koi aadmi jo hamara interview kar raha hai. To ye something very interesting is happening within the society. Within the Dalit community, you talk to a Dalit activist, you collect all literature written by Dalits. It is all about how Dalits fail. It is all about how Dalits are discriminated. That is a reality. But how a Dalit with this eighth grade education could buy 3 luxury cars? A Dalit woman I met in Lucknow, I tweeted it, I didn't write price. She has a 24 lakh diamond necklace. A Dalit lady in Patna I met on 23rd, I tweeted it, that this gold necklace is worth 10 lakh rupees. So there is not a single novel, fiction, story, short story, poem, song, where a Dalit was born into poverty and discrimination, could not wear shoes till he got into medical college, and now he has a bike worth 18 lakh rupees. So even in jokes, you don't find Dalits riding a BMW or a Mercedes. So there is something very deeply disconnected in terms of knowledge about Dalits.
I want to say something about Dalits riding BMWs and expensive cars. You know what's the flip side? It's not just regarding Dalit entrepreneurs. In general, for business people in India, if you are doing business and if you are succeeding means you are a crook, you cheat your customers, you evade taxes, you pay bribes. One of the outcomes of this culture is Chandrabhanji met one entrepreneur near Delhi who was having a BMW. But when he asked him, he said that no, he's having a Maruti Zen or some such thing. He said when after he bought that BMW, all kinds of inspectors and taxmen started calling him. So sometimes even demonstrating your wealth is not a good thing in India. But let me come to the larger point about why we make so much about a few examples. It's about social change. It's about the belief in the community that they can do it. Yes, we can do it. I'll give you one example from the US. In 1930s, for the first time, the government started employing blacks as policemen in the South, in Texas and New Mexico kind of areas. The idea that a black policeman would go and arrest a white criminal electrified the community. It's not that black policemen went and arrested thousands and thousands of white men. This may be few instances here and there, but it gave the community one, yes, they can do it under certain circumstances.
You're talking about the importance of the positive message.
Yes. Signaling effect the Dalit entrepreneurs are having on the community. In 10 years, now if you go across the country and meet young Dalit and tribal youth and ask them, what do you want to? A generation ago, almost 99% would have said that I want to become a government employee. Now I would say maybe 10-15% would say I want to become a businessman. That's a staggering change in terms of Indian trajectory.
I'll ask one last question to Chandrabhan. After that, we'll have maybe questions and answer if anybody wants to ask something. In all this, you know, recently you've written about the need for Dalit banks. Can you just tell us briefly about your concept? Yeah, take the mic, please.
I was there for very briefly in the U.S. In the University of Pennsylvania and had occasion to meet plenty of blacks. Blacks, American blacks, have a very rich history of creating financial institutions. Yeah. Very rich history. And many affluent blacks just go to a financial institution created by some black in the neighborhood and drop $100. Just mera naam mat likhna. This money belongs to your institute, you give it to somebody who is doing business. Dalit, there are 9,26,000 plus Dalit school teachers in this country, only scheduled caste. Their combined salary per year is 5 billion rupees. Even if 1% was put into a Dalit bank or financial institution, it becomes how much? 555 crore. So Dalit wealth is like a flood water coming from somewhere and going down the drain. Not one rupee is preserved in a common large account. And we are doing research, T. Shambhabuji and me, on Thakursa of Uttar Pradesh, a district in UP called Azamgarh. We are going a week later again. I asked Thakur, what has, they themselves start telling that they have declined. What has impacted negatively most? They say, Zamindari abolition. Zamindari abolition hamara pair, hamari kamar tod di. I have a fear, like many, that by the year 2050, public sector and public sector banks might disappear completely. And what Thakurs are today, Dalit middle class might turn like that. So Dalits should, whatever they're earning, they should try to preserve into banks, into financial institutions, liberate Dalits from debt trap. As I wrote in your newspaper, Ratibhai Makwana pays 6 crore in interest every year. 7 crore interest. His younger brother pays 6 crore rupees in interest every year to banks. So this community, we are campaigning that you should create your bank, create financial institutions, create Tata Trust like thing where you can have huge amount of money and keep giving to this industry, to that industry. So this, we are trying to, in a way, create a kind of renaissance in the Dalit middle class.
Okay. Just opening the floor to questions here. Yeah.
So there are three kinds of enterprise, you know, entrepreneurs in this country. One is born entrepreneurs like Tata's and Birla. There are professional entrepreneurs like Bhavish Agarwal and all, say Vijay Shekhar Sharma. There are barefoot entrepreneurs, which is almost 90 to 95% in India. They are driving the economy, you know. And largely these enterprise, barefoot enterprises, are mostly from the Dalit background, right? So there are two events happened within the last 5 years. One is demonetization and another one is the GST. How you are seeing that that is impacting them as a large, you know, pool of enterprise. They are not, you know, meeting compliance and they are not getting enough, you know, support to get their business up and running at a large scale. What is your view? Second question I would like to, you know, add here. So there are caste divide, which was there, always there historically. But there are another divide which is getting created, like there is the IIT-IIM divide for entrepreneurship. So if you are in this league, you will get, you know, money from venture capital, money from banks, money from your internal entrepreneurs, you know, they are also putting money. But the rest of them is very, you know, difficult to find any sort of capital to start business. What is the views of panel?
So the second view question, I think, has been answered a little, but first question on the effect of demonetization.
Dalit businesses very greatly, and Dalits are not able to market themselves and their products. I don't want to name. We went to a big international funding agency in Delhi, asking for a project, money to study Dalit entrepreneurs. We were declined. Somebody said, had you gone there with a proposal to study violence against Dalits, discrimination against Dalits, there is so much of fund floating in Delhi. But if you want a project, a money from a funding agency, international funding agency, worried about poor and untouchables and tribals, and say that we want 1 crore rupees per year to send experts to every scheduled caste, scheduled tribe hostel to train the boys and girls how to make necktie.
Thank you.
In US, blacks do it. There will be no funding agency willing to support this endeavor. So, to create positive things, there is no funding neither by the government, nor by Dalit middle class, nor by any international agency. And
do you agree with his view that there is a class divide as far as giving funds and all that is concerned? People, you know, people with a certain background,
yes,
social confidence, you know, they bring on the table. That
yes,
gets that, it's easier
that,
for them to get loans.
Dalit needs,
that's your question, yes, right?
Yeah. That Dalit needs so badly. Otherwise, why should a Dalit think that he has Jaguar, but he doesn't have Thai because he thinks he doesn't know English, so he cannot.
That divide is not only impacting Dalit, it's impacting everyone else.
Exactly.
So that's the idea.
No, he's saying that while the class divide is there, but within the class divide, people with an additional baggage of a certain social kind are further disadvantaged.
Can I ask?
Probably. Yeah, please.
You know, Chandbanji and Shyamji and Yamini, I think you're pretty much on the mark when you say that there is a convergence between people's reactions to Dalits and the Dalits' attitude about the language and such like, which I think is because it would be the same for any poor person in India in the rural areas, farmers, etc. If a rich farmer did well in one season and bought a, you know, expensive car, he would pretty much still be uncomfortable wearing a tie, so it's not a Dalit issue. But what I'm concerned about and what I'd like to know is, why is it that Dalits are not able to form their guilds and leagues and talk about entrepreneurship, talk about modern training systems for their young boys and girls like the blacks? Is it because of historically they feel repressed, or is there something societal which is holding them back even today, especially when government has made so many modern changes and so much has been done?
I think it is, firstly, culture has the signaling effect. Culture tells you, not culture, Dalits tell Dalit entrepreneur, don't act like a baniya. Only baniyas can succeed in business. You don't get into this. That is one. The second is, unlike blacks, we tend to treat Dalits as one homogeneous group. They are not. They are into different castes and they are divided. So even to develop some kind of social capital among them is extremely difficult. So these two factors actually affect the...
professional thinkers. As far as I can know, I have studied in JNU, those bright and talented got sucked by UPSC, raised by banks, state level civil services, and other government jobs. Those Dalits who could not compete within Dalits turned into Dalit thinker and opinion maker.
That's not restricted.
Those who got into PhD and became professors, they did so because for 6, 7, 8 attempts they could not pass civil service, but kept doing PhD so that they can retain the hostel. And later they became lecturers. Maybe next generation Dalit youth now, which is opting for PhD, opting for law course, not going to engineering, not writing civil service, maybe 50 years later something new will come.
But I just wanted to say that you can't divorce the how Dalits mobilize, how they create institutions for shared solidarity and for building communities, from the larger context of the socioeconomic context in which all of this is happening. If you just look across the board, unionization, professional institutions, whether it is the chartered accountants, legal, there's been a very consistent atrophy. And where mobilization is at its most significant is when it's about extracting from or trying to get better benefits of the state. And I think that is it's a larger, much more deeper institutional constraint that India needs to confront, in which then communities with their own unique, particular kinds of mobilizational needs also then start suffering.
Last question. So, yeah. Achha, anyway, huh? Please.
Few years ago, we read the newspaper, the first Dalit Chamber of Commerce formed in Ranchi or Jharkhand. I couldn't remember that, which year it was. So what is the status now? So there is, it still is functioning and more Dalit entrepreneurs joining on that Chamber of Commerce.
I think there are many, several such MEPs have come into in every state, but these bodies are also not run professionally the way CII or FICCI or SOCHAM are run. So maybe the next generation will take the lead.
My name is Vijay Saluja. I want to know your views about reservations for really meritorious jobs or positions like IITs or IIMs or IES, because I feel, I would like to know your views, because to my mind the merit should be the only criteria, not that any caste or something. So I need to know, especially for doctors and engineers and things. You know.
I am product of reservation. How do you judge me now?
Briefly, My answer to your question is, yes, merit should be the only criterion. But if you can create a situation where you can measure somebody's merit anonymously, anybody will make it. But now our system is so subjective. You look at somebody's gender, caste, religion, region, and give marks. Let us create a system where it is anonymous. Dalits and tribals, anybody will make it.
So I would like to add to that. Actually, don't you think that the barrier to entry in India is quite a little bit high? I will give you my own example. 2 years back, I started a business in US. The first business didn't work out. The second didn't work out. The third one took off within a week. That's because I was able to start that business without any legal complications, anything. I just set up something, some website and all, and it literally took off. And this year I thought of starting that same business in India, but I couldn't because a lot of like GSTs and all. I needed a GST number to start to get a payment gateway in India, but I couldn't get that number because I was like under 18 or something like that. They didn't accept me. So isn't it like that if the barrier is in India is quite a bit high? So. And I'm not only talking about Dalits and entrepreneurship in general. If I were given a chance like I was given in US, in India, so don't you think entrepreneurship should have been a little bit easier in India? And it should have taken off?
Yes, it should, across the board. To the question on reservation, as a student, I wrote a long essay on how it should all be based on merit. Pushed hard for that. As an adult and as an institution builder, I have begun to recognize how difficult it is to find within my community of practice diversity of that nature. And it does, so it's a hard question. If I put on my institution building hat, if anybody were to constrain my hands in terms of who I can hire, what kind of students I can have, and so on and so forth, it does make me feel extremely constrained and feel very uncomfortable with having to think about with the idea of reservation or affirmative action. But if you look around at what then gets thrown up and the barriers to entry that creates, there are also important questions. There is no right answer. Ultimately, we perhaps would not have had to ask these questions if the basic foundations of what we were to build in our society, a solid education and freedom, equity, liberty, and justice. We would not have had to ask these questions, but that's not the society we have today. So we have to think about what is it about the reservation policy that undermined the effectiveness of institutions to function, and what is it that actually created mobility among structurally marginalized communities, and how we balance those.
Very good afternoon to all the panelists and everybody sitting here. Just a remark, if you were here before, the Ramayan conference or the discussion had a little more number of people sitting here than following the question. There are about 23 unicorns in India, and 17 are owned by very privileged upper caste citizens. How do we break that barrier, that ceiling? And again, to Mr. Bhan, language is very important. My parents recommended and made sure that I went to a good school and learned English so that I could wear a tie. And secondly, how much time would it take for us to not recognize people from our own identity and from our own society who've done well, like the likes of Palwakar Balu and others who've done well, and just hold ourselves to a few?
Can I get back and answer this young man's question? Yeah. I wish we had started from your point. That Dalits are a subset of poor in India. And poor have no say in this country. It's not about starting a business. If you are a villager, you're a Brahmin villager, very poor. If somebody snatches away one of your family members, you are not really sure that police will act. You are not really sure that courts will stand by you. What to talk about starting a business? So we have a huge problem, and Dalits being the lowest of the low, they tend to be far worse victims of the system. It's a sad thing.
Yeah, his answer is the first Dalit unicorn, that kind of a question you had?
Yeah, absolutely, because there are 17 of the unicorns. You can easily identify them because your last name is the identification.
By unicorn, you mean a billion-dollar company?
Yeah, billion-dollar company in technologies, to be specific.
Yeah. He's saying, can Dalits have a company, a technology company, which has a valuation of $1 billion, which makes a unicorn? So can Dalits reach that level? I think you raised that question.
How we can break the glass ceiling? How we can get there?
His IT company is worth $300 million.
This is the last question.
His company is worth $300 million. I have not met him, but I am in touch with him. There is a young Dalit in Bombay. His company is also quite big, but not $1 billion, I would say. He stays 15 days in India, 15 days in Silicon Valley. So he partners with an American company. He's a partner in an American company, and he runs in Bombay his own company. But maybe he's around $300 million. This is just the beginning of the journey.
You see, what he's saying is that the destination, if $1 billion is the destination, then there's still some way of attaining it, but they're on the way.
It's pretty easy for them to do it. Why are you making reservation? Why is this gentleman talking about reservation? I'm able to speak English because I got reservation. He's sitting there because he's got reservation. I mean, change your head a little. Think about it wisely.
I hope the session was interesting for you guys. We will come to the end of it. Thanks.